You know, we're starting this day and this week off right. Ooh, it's pitch black in the morning. Oh man, it's a little overcast and gloomy today, but don't worry. I'm here to bring a smile to your face and some sunshine into your life. That's what I do on this channel. Actually, that's not my main goal. My main goal is spending the day in the shop, fixing a whole bunch of cars and trucks. You guys that have been around a while have seen the classics, the European exotics, Asians, domestics, even trucks, medium duty trucks now. We do all kinds of stuff around here in this channel. We're gonna put some clips in of what might happen in today's video, and even more accurately, what's gonna happen in today's video. 2017 Chevy Traverse. 2012 Hyundai Elantra. Another quality, generous motors product. Now, it's not always this gloomy and overcast in Central Florida, but this time of the year, we get a little bit more inclement weather. Right now, it's a chilly 58 degrees. I apologize to those of you out there in Iowa in that area where it's under zero, which means it's basically no temperature or less than no temperature. I don't know how that's possible, but I don't control the weather. Let's, you guys know what's going on because of the clips I just showed you, but I have no idea yet. So I'm interested to find out too. Finish opening this shop up, try to learn a thing or two, have some fun and get started. Stay tuned. Chevy Traverse. I'm gonna get a tune-up, oil change, and a couple of little services. They're gonna drain and fill the radiator. Oh man, the hood was stuck closed. Hasn't been open in a while. Oh yeah, let's take a look inside. There's an engine down in there somewhere. 101,011 miles. Oil change soon, light is on, so we can take care of that. We'll turn the key on and then go 1, 2, 3. Sometimes I'll give it an extra hit or two for fun. And we go like this. Odometer, trip, B, range. Just pushing a little dash control buttons. Economy, 19 mpg. That's not bad for a big car like this. I want to make sure I'm not seeing a oil change mileage reminder. It's gone. So we should be good. Now I can also do this. Tire pressure. Calibrate compass. No, we don't want that. 100% oil life remaining. So we know our reset worked. Now we just got to do it. Oil change prep. And since I got to do a tune-up, I'm go ahead and take this plenum off of here too. Got all my oil passages crankcase openings plugged off so I can blow some of the sand and dust out of here. We gotta take the plenum off too. I'll have to go over it again with the shop air once I get the plenum out of the way. I'll cover the ports and blow out the dust and dirt around the coils underneath there somewhere. Get out of here, old oil, will you? Ooh, that was... Looks like it was ready for an oil change. You know where it turns the oil black? Is carbon. Combustion. Get this old nasty gasket out of there. We'll get us a nice new one. Way more better. You cannot achieve new car status by reusing a worn out O-ring. This is the one that GM thought would be cool to put the oil filter up there. So you can kind of get to it, but you can't get your hand there. And you can't get your hand up there. So you gotta do these from the top with a drain pan on the floor. Or you can make a mess on the floor, it's up to you. I'm not telling you how to do it, just how I do it. Certainly can't turn it by hand. They had a 27060 on it before, but it's supposed to have a 27356 supposedly. It looks totally different. Maybe they gave me the wrong part number because I can't thread this one on. This one, the filter will fit on. Made in China, where all the good stuff comes from.
I took a picture of this plate.
Ah, oh, that's why it didn't work. I think 27060 is it, but I got 5 minutes and they're trying to thread it on, but it looks like the same size threads. The way they do these filters down by the cat.
It's nice. Yeah. Yeah, right?
Got a third one to try. This one's made in Mexico, so I know it'll fit. Threads on about 2 inches.
Really?
Yeah, the thread for the filter. I like that one. But this is the right filter. Yay! Let's get the dinosaur blood in here. I'm 30 synthetic. That's a 4.5 quarts and a check. It's sour on the quantity yet. It's about 5.5 quarts. You got a half right here. Hit him! Take these screws all the way out. Just gotta loosen them. Your filter's in good shape, which I suspected. Still gotta make sure. I'm gonna shuffle the filter into the housing. They make this so hard that most people probably don't check it very often, but especially with a tuna, I gotta take a look. I say tune-up, but it's really no such thing anymore. It's a spark plug replacement. And because we're doing a coolant service on these GM SUVs, they hide the radiator cap under this plastic shroud because they don't want you to mess with it, I guess. This tool doesn't fit when you gotta take all these plastic clips out. You can't have it open and fit it in there. So I use a pocket screwdriver to kind of start it. And then my little needle nose. I'm sure GM has a special tool for it. You guys know, I try to avoid them unless I cannot go without it. Or if it saves me enough time to justify the expense. I think I've got them all now. Oh, the weather stripping's attached to it too. Gotta be careful of that. Gotta be careful of that. All right, now we can check the coolant level. I don't think they really want anyone to check the coolant level. That way you'll burn up an engine and buy another one, but it won't be a GM probably. All right, it's gonna get noisy, but this is my little evacuation tool. It's a mighty vac. These are a little pricey if you're on a budget. It's not something you have to have. You can just open the drain and drain it out. But we're doing a coolant service, drain and fill, so I'm just gonna suck out. It'll get 90% of the fluid out. And I'm going to suck out the overflow or reservoir tank on this. It is just an overflow tank. It's not an expansion tank. It's not pressurized. It's just excess coolant goes in under pressure and gets drawn back in when it cools down to make sure that there's no air in the system. So I'll just use this, a hook shop air to it. It'll pull the fluid out for me. It's going to get kind of noisy. Thank you. goes all the way to the bottom of the radiator, just the same as draining it. I know some people will say you can't get it all out that way, but if you do regular maintenance on your system, on the cooling system, and you're not going 10 years without doing it, then this method is fine. If the system's gotten gummed up and messed up and crudded up, then it's too late. Because when you run a flush machine or anything on them, you make the phone ring, and any clogged tubes, the flushing process doesn't clean. If that makes sense. If the tubes are plugged, nothing goes through it to clean it, right? So if half the radiator flows, half the radiator gets flushed. So if you're better off, much better off doing drain and fills on a regular basis and not letting it go too long. Ah, I spilled a little. That's it. We don't charge them for whatever we spill. That's a nickel off the ticket, please. That's a gallon and a half. Perfect.
You know what? Maybe we'll do this without taking the plenum off.
Huh. Cool. Even easier than I thought. I think I'd just take the purge valve out of here and lift that coil straight out. And the boots are usually a little rubbery depending on how stiff the plug coil to plug boot is. Some of them are soft and they'll bend, some of them are a little plastic. You gotta have some more room, so I think I can do it without pulling the plenum. 10 millimeter holds that in. And that's even another thing I probably don't have to do. But when you get a little older like me, you just make it easier, even if it takes a minute or two longer. You want to make it a little easier to do. Man, that's going to be nice. It might touch here, but we'll see. I don't think it will. You guys want to place your bets in the comments?
Uh-oh. It's our first roadblock. A hose. Don't worry. These have the little security latch deals, so you got to undo this little security tab and we'll let you squeeze it.
It's kind of like if you buy it dinner and everything's good to go. that's not funny. Come on, man.
I'm trying to see one of the easier ones.
Yeah, that's solid as a rock. You can't, there's no give.
That might be a plenum removal one.
If I do have to remove it, I could probably loosen it and just lift it up enough. We'll see. Those two barely fit out, and this one, much the same. It's like GM put those corners on there so it would fit out. It's so thoughtful. I doubt that's the case, but I like to pretend it is. The little spark plugs are right down there. Got the 6.0 in the right angle, but we got a lot of extensions, so it's gonna balance it out. We'll see what happens. Some people might not like the impact used to do spark plugs, but it doesn't hurt anything. Trust me, I wouldn't steer you wrong. AC Delcos are coming out and the Bosch is going in. The one of the tricks on the Ford 5.4 is three valves. When the plugs get carboned up and stuck, they use an impact to take them out because the hammering kind of busts the carbon loose as it pulls it out. Anyway, I think the plugs are here. Let's go find them. That is the beautiful Bosch Platinum. Mm-mm-mm. Now, you can impact them in, but I always start them by hand. You don't put any anti-seize or anything on these plugs. They're nickel plated. Start it by hand. Pause it down. Just to save the pickle juicers a bit. Now I'll use a hand ratchet to finalize the tight tension. And these are tapered seat, so you don't go a full turn after it touches. You go maybe a quarter of a turn. They stop. That's tight. Sometimes I give it a little extra bump. I'm gonna do all the plugs before I put the coils in, and before I put them in, we'll put some fresh dielectric grease in there just a little to help with release next time and seal them from moisture. The back's gonna be similar, except I'll have to mess with the extensions a lot to clear the firewall, I think. We'll see. Now all that, that's enough for all three boots. You don't need a lot of this stuff. Everyone overdoes it. You don't need a lot. That's what I'm trying to say. Quarter drive, extended reach, coming out of the cabinet. I think we're gonna get this done without a plenum R&R. I did pop the little pin that holds the harness to the valve cover, because that first connector, man, it doesn't want to slide back. The harness is right behind it. So when I pulled that pin out of the valve cover, it let it move off the coil, so. And what I'll do is see how many extensions it takes to stack up, like a Build-A-Bear, but a build-in extension. Now that 3-inch one is almost flush with the valve cover, so another 3-inch one, and I should have room to swing a ratchet in there. I have a set of Williams extensions, which I think Snap-on owns them now, but that's how they, a lot of things they'll have a third-party vendor make, and then they end up buying them out. My set that I got, I bought a bunch of Williams extensions, I think it was on eBay. They're brand new, from Williams. They have a William, they have an eBay store, USA. But my set wasn't right. It had 2 3-inch extensions and no 4-inch. And guess what I need right now? A four inch. So now I'll probably just add a 1-inch to that, because I don't have a 4-inch extension. Oh, you know what? I might have a gear wrench 4-inch. Well, I thought I had a 4-inch, but apparently only in quarter drive. That's maybe what I was remembering. So, we'll go back to the 1-inch extension and the 2 3-inch extension and get a 7-inch extension. Because it's hard to get to back here and there's a little more going on, I'll do one coil start, one plug start to finish at a time. And I'll go on to the next one. Just a little too much discombobulated at one time, I guess. I'll probably pop all the electrical connectors on at one time afterwards, though, so I keep that harness out of my way. All right, last plug. Let me get this ready to go. Use my quarter drive to do this one. Don't go flashlight. Stay with me now. As long as I get that height pretty good, as far as extensions go, it's not too bad, really. Get the light to stay where it is, that's the only complicated part. Get my adapter on my quarter drive. This is the perfect thing for an extended reach ratchet. Got pretty decent power too. Uh-oh. You're in trouble now, mister. Respect my authority. You got the weird brown tinge from, I don't know if that's additives or something. That's kind of strange. You guys seen that before? I think it's fuel additives or something like that. Could just be in the fuel he's buying, if it maybe premium burns like that. This is the guy that owns the Jeep, by the way, that I put the 3 oil coolers in. He was happy that we did a good job. We took care of him and warrantied it every time and didn't cost him a penny. Just a little inconvenience, but he was happy we upgraded it for him, no charge, and apologized for the trouble. He's like, here, do my other car. I need some maintenance. So, anyway, last plug. I always check, make sure the ground didn't take a hit. And I've said before, if you haven't seen, don't put a gapper in these. It's double platinum. Not a good idea. If you do want to gap them, if something's damaged, you probably should just send it back. But you can grab this electrode and get it parallel with the casing of the plug. If it's for the right application, it's already gapped.
I know some people might not like that. That's okay.
If people don't like something they see in your content. I was watching Dan from DD Speed Shop last night. He had like a 40-minute video, and like 20 minutes of it, he was explaining himself to people who complained about what he was doing. I'm like, I mean, I do that to a little bit.
Don't go overboard. You don't owe anybody an explanation. On occasion, maybe.
But most of the time, someone will tell you something that just has more experience at it. Nobody knows everything.
All right.
One coil away.
We all want to do the best job we know how. And a lot of times, you're just learning something. You don't do it a lot. You do it the first or second time. Someone might know more, but there comes a point where between people giving you helpful tips or making a positive comment, and sometimes they're just being nasty and just giving me a hard time. I responded to a couple comments this morning where guys were just busting my chops a little bit, and they were trying to be funny, and I think I responded as if they weren't. And then like 5 minutes later, I'm thinking about it going, those guys are probably just messing around.
you're always dancing.
That's all right. Last one. Stop yapping. Get it done. Go. Hello. Electrical connector. I think I already got it. Yep. Safety's on. Latched.
I pushed the pin. Whoa. I pushed the pin back in the valve cover.
Everything is all good.
Now I got to do an induction service. And it's all done.
Okay.
I'm gonna fire this thing up, make sure the coolant's topped up. We'll back it up and hook up the induction. I'm gonna go to, I have to find a hose here. One of these hoses will work, probably this one right here. I believe this hose will do the job. Anything that's manifold vacuum that you can tee into, anything behind the throttle body is manifold vacuum. When the throttle body is closed, it's under a vacuum. The throttle body opens, the vacuum drops way off. So you can't, if you try doing it from here, there's no vacuum unless you off throttle, which you do these around 1500 to 2000 RPM, and it takes about 45 minutes, an hour altogether, but all the different chemicals. One goes in the tank, then there's a foam, and then there's a liquid that you put in a separate dispenser. So, stop talking about it and do it. I keep a couple of rubber elbows around. When I do an engine or something, I get parts from the junkyard off of them. I'll keep the elbows in case I need them for repair or for something just like this, because that inlet is pretty big. So, that'll fit right in there. This will fit right in there. And everybody's happy. Now I gotta fire it up. I moved it out of the shop a little bit so everyone doesn't have to smell it with me as much. They'll still smell it. They'll still get to enjoy it, but to a lesser degree. Now, this is my little throttle stop dealio. You got very precise adjustments. Some cars will fight you more than others, but for the most part, 1500 to 2000, maybe 2500 max, until we get this can through in two or three different stages. You put in a third of the can, let it sit about 10 minutes, put in the next third, 10 minutes. That's what makes it take some time. Hopefully there's something else to do while you're waiting. But to do it right, it takes a while. Some guys just blow the stuff in there, drive it down the road with all smoking out of the exhaust for 5 minutes, and then it cleans the cat really good. That should be good right there. If you try to push it and get it perfectly on 2000, you can spend a few minutes. So once it's close, I'm generally pretty happy with it. I trickle this in pretty slow. I never go full throttle. Because you stall the engine, and if you go really crazy, you can hydrolock an engine and bend connecting rods and crazy stuff. So you gotta be careful. I don't believe they even sell these winds kits to the public, but there are similar products you can buy from like Lucas and STP and things like that. Direct inject an engine, putting stuff in the gas tank, helps clean the injectors, but it won't clean the carbon off the valves. This service is for cleaning carbon off the valves. That's why it goes in the air of the intake rather than on the fuel side of the intake. We're running this through the air passages to get to the back of the intake valves. The carbon gets bad on the valves from poor maintenance with oil changes, combustion in the gas from PCV not working quite right, or it's just a natural process that also happens, but it takes longer if the maintenance is done well. So we'll run this through three stages, and we'll come back when we're finishing up. Yep. That's the end of that can. On to the next phase in the operation. I'm gonna let that finish pulling whatever's in there to kind of clear itself out, and then we'll shut it off, let it sit again. That'll be the third time. Now, it might not look like anything's coming out of there, but if you look down there, that's why it takes a long time, and that's how it does the most effective job. I guess you'd consider this like a flush that helps. That other product softens the carbon, and this helps flush the carbon off, and then it gets cooked up in a cat and passed out the exhaust, allegedly. I've done these services and taken engines apart, 6-8 months later. Quite a bit of carbon still on the valves, but I do still think it helps. But it doesn't make the valves like brand new. If the carbon's already been hardened on there, it's gonna be really hard to get it off. This is something that you do before the carbon gets too bad. You do it every 2 or 3 years, maybe sooner if you drive a lot more. It's one of those things that it's good to do more often than less often, but it's kind of expensive. By the time you're done with the materials and the labor, it's like $200, $250, so. Something you could do yourself if you're capable of doing that. You could save some money but just by buying a product and putting it in once in a while. Just be careful with how fast you feed it. You could probably buy this kit for about $45 and just get some of the chemical and run it through on an intake port. Something with a fixed orifice so you don't have to worry about overdoing it. And it'll help your idle quality, gas mileage, power, because when a valve's carboned up, it messes with the airflow. Creates turbulence you don't want. The engineers have done a lot to control the airflow into the engine and out of the engine. And that carbon causes tons of problems. People blame it on spark. I've seen people do tune-ups and coils and stuff because there's carbon on the valve causing a misfire. So let's let this run a little while and we'll come back. Maybe take the sink for a drive. I think I got power windows to check next. All right, took her on a road test. Drove really good. Everything's good. But the brake pedal gives this weird squeak. So I'm going to lubricate it to the best of my ability. See if we can quiet her down. Very strange. Looks like someone's been spraying stuff in here, but it's hard to tell. I don't want it to be dripping all over the place on people's shoes and stuff, though, so, you know, see if we can get rid of it. It almost sounds like the push rod going in the booster. Ah, I was hoping something simple would do it. 2012 Hyundai Elantra. Customer states, only my driver's window works. And can you throw some wiper blades on there for me? I don't really think she said tro. I just embellished a little bit. 128,466 miles. Pretty clean inside. This thing's like a 7. Very nice. Oh, I figured out what's wrong with the windows. Only the driver's works. Fixed it. Actually, let's check them all just to be sure. Right rear, left rear.
Aha. So something's been wrong with the left rear for a while, and then she accidentally pushed that button and disabled the other ones. So if you push this button, it's to keep your kids or the nuisance teenagers or your 38-year-old uncle that won't stop playing with the windows. That stops them from doing it, and they can't do anything with their windows, and you can't either. It takes away the ground. So, but what it does have is a problem with the left rear window regulator. I can hear the motor go conk and stop like the cable's broken. Someone probably even put a screw in it years ago. It's a little old lady, very nice. So we're gonna take good care of her. We're not gonna charge her for the window not working diag, because it was just a button. Of course, I'll make a short about it because it's pretty funny. But matter of fact, I leave this in the middle too, because if you accidentally bump this, it moves your mirrors, right? So if you leave it in the middle, it doesn't move any mirrors when you move it. You put it on the left, and the mirror moves. Put it in the middle, mirror doesn't move. Right? Anyway, some of this stuff, people, it's amazing to me that people don't go through the owner's manual and figure things out, but, you know, everyone's busy, I guess, right? Let's give them an estimate for the left rear window regulator and throw some wiper blades on it. It's a 23 and an 18-inch blade, I believe it takes. Definitely don't want them flying off going down the turnpike. That's what we call a highway here, because you pay tolls. All right, my next one's a strange one. Chevy Malibu. Another shop recommended a BCM. He said he has a rough idle, slow acceleration, and a transmission leak. And another shop recommended a BCM. 2016 Malibu. All right, so basically we're gonna start from scratch, see what we can find wrong with it. Disregard all the information, see what happens. Oh yeah, another quality Generous Motors product. She's in a world hurt driving it in. Feels like it's running on three cylinders. So we're gonna find out why. The check engine light's blinking. I would be willing to bet someone a week's pay that it's not related to the BCM, but that's a risk you're willing to take. Contact me in the email section. JimmyMakingItWork@yahoo.com. Should be in the description below. Let's get the scanner. Stop that annoying key chime. Take a look inside. 97,000 miles. Love rating of 6, actually. It's pretty clean inside. I don't see any real big issues. Definitely no food or anything like that. Uh-oh, gotta do my updates first. We'll knock those updates out. Go ahead and update. Oh, BMW, oh, that might take a little while. German cars, for some reason, are always the slowest. Oh, we'll let that work, and we'll come back. Scan all the modules, because it's got codes in the TPMS, and he said something about BCM, so... Let's get all our codes in a list, send a report, and then we'll go over them. Well, we got codes. We got the two ECM codes, one chassis control module code, two EBCM codes, and five BCM codes. So it must need a BCM, I'm guessing. Current. Engine misfire detected. Chassis control module requested MIL illumination. Active grille shutter performance. Invalid data from BCM, invalid data. Tire pressure remote control door lock receiver data circuit. Left front tire pressure sensor low voltage. Left front tire pressure sensor too few pulses. Left rear low voltage. Left rear too. So it's probably got two bad TPMS sensors. And something is going on with information coming from the ECM or BCM, and the EBCM sees that invalid data and goes, hey man, something's wrong. This one's current. So that's probably where we're gonna need to head first, I would think. The problem is, this thing has a wicked misfire.
I want to find out why, what cylinder, and take a look at a spark plug. If you look at a spark plug and it's wet with gas, you know, it probably has no spark. If it has a gas and oily kind of smell to it or texture to it, then it may have a compression problem. And if the spark plug's dry and it's misfiring, it's probably not getting fuel right. So we're going to bring up misfire data first, try to see if we can nail that misfire, figure out what cylinder is and what might be going on there. Then we'll worry about these other things. Like we've seen on a couple of vehicles lately where I've had air temp sensors that were unplugged. The air temp sensor in the one mirror was broken. So, and when those things, weird things happen like that, some of these modules freak out and give you codes like that. So we may need to investigate that afterwards too. Let's sort out the misfire first. That's the blink and check engine light. That's like if you go into the hospital with a broken arm and a headache, they're gonna fix your arm first, right? Same thing. All right, we go into ECM. There should be a function GMs for a compression deal. Let's see if it has a compression test. And it'll tell you to press the gas, crank it over, and it'll tell you if it sees something it does not like. So, throttle position. I'm gonna give it some gas. It should tell you. It doesn't say anything about pressing the gas, huh? That's kind of strange. Let's go, compression test. Actually sounds pretty good. I didn't hear anything going on with compression. Everything sounded like it was cranking evenly. The 100% way, if you have a doubt, is with an amp clamp, and you bring up a scope with cylinder one, you can figure out which cylinder. But to me, it's a lot easier just to look at misfire data while it's running, figure out which cylinder it is. You could look at the spark plugs and you'll see one of them be wet with fuel or oil or something. You won't need to get too crazy. Doing it with the scope is really cool, but it's not really necessary. But of course, I do have to find my misfire screen. Maybe in data, it'll have a misfire page. There it is, misfire data. I'm gonna bring up cylinder 1, 2, and 3. And I'm even gonna bring up cylinder 4 too. And we'll see what's happening with that. Let's start it up. Okay. Cylinder 2 is not at all happy. You can bring it up and graph, combine. Each color represents a cylinder. All the ones not misfiring are down here at the bottom, 0. So we definitely gotta look at cylinder 2 and see what that plug looks like. Let's get the engine cover out of the way. You got some interesting hardware. Took it out of a IKEA bed frame or something. I don't know. It works, I guess. Cylinder 2. Let's get us a peeky poo. It's leaking tranny fluid really bad. There's a puddle of tranny fluid under there, so something going on with that. But I still want to look at this misfiring culprit first. So we know what's wrong with this one. I'm gonna see if I can find a coil. And, well, I don't even really need to, but I do want to get a coil in it, make sure it runs good. I can't run it too much because the tranny's pouring out tranny fluid too. This looks like it says Delphi, so it might be original. It's under a beautiful cover that fits really well to the top of the head, or the top of the valve cover. It's got an engine cover that fits really well to the valve cover. That's it. So it keeps them looking new. But that one's a different color. We know it's been changed. Let's see if I got a test coil. Maybe I do. We can at least run it, get it running good for a second, and we know that it's going to run good once we do a repair. I thought that was grease, but I went to wipe it off. It doesn't wipe off. It's like JB Weld. That tells me they saw the halo effect that happens around that spark plug from the, you know, if you ever look at them in the dark when they're firing, there's a little aura kind of halo thingamajig going on there. It's a little bit of the feng shui stuff. And they put JB Weld on to fix it so it didn't leak compression and cause a misfire. They're mechanics, so. I can't find a test coil. I'm just gonna lift it up and see if I can figure out where the tranny's leaking, and we'll go from there. See if they want to get a coil for me to pop on there real quick. Uh-oh. Well, fluid is running down everywhere. Maybe it's coming from the top, running down the tranny case. I wonder if there's a quick connect. It's not plugged in all the way kind of thing or something. It drove in the shop though, under its own power, but it's leaking fluid pretty good. I'm definitely thinking BCM now. It's really not funny. That's what makes it funny, because when something's really silly, I find it funny. Anywho, he also put a note. I noticed that gave me his note, handwritten note. It says, I believe everyone deserves a second chance and should be forgiven. Which is a very nice sentiment. I believe that too. Let's see if we can figure out what's wrong with his car. And hopefully he forgives us, because all we're going to do is tell the truth, right?
No.
Alright, I'm going to put it in use again. Let's see if we can find a leak down here. Looks like the side cover dealio. Yeah. You can see it with me. So it's coming from above there. Oh, there's a line there.
This hit bent the hell out of it. And it's all four tires.
That line's got damage too. Looks like it was pushed on by something.
The one that's out there was hitting on this
down. See the line there? That's a 13 millimeter.
I was like, yeah, that's pretty cool. How much are the rims for this thing? You know, I don't know. I can't put those estimates together.
Line's leaking. Is the gasket on that line or the line's cracked? I'm making a little list. All right, I had Bill fired up for me so we could watch the leak coming out of the line. Took a picture of it with the V-Bore articulating boroscope endoscope colonoscopy camera. That's what everyone keeps calling it. That's what it will be from now on. So we're just making a little list on this car. The line might have cracked inside there. If it was the O-ring gasket, I would think would only leak out this way. It's hard to say, but I'm going to assume that line's cracked or something. We'll need to take it apart to see 100%. And I don't even know if the customer has any money at this point yet. So we're just compiling a little list, and we'll keep coming back to it as I find stuff. All right, we got plugs, coil on cylinder two, transcooler hose or line, a metal line. Should we recommend them all? We don't know if the other ones have fatigue, if something's going on with someone worked on and cracked something. A lot of times where there's a little, where the bubble flare is in the line, it's pushed together and holds that O-ring into the tranny, they'll crack around where it's been compressed. They get a stress fracture, especially if someone pries on something or something like that. It's, you know, anything's possible, but to avoid potential problems, you got to at least recommend the other lines with it while we're in there doing that line. It's just another part. It's not more labor, right? So, and then clearing the codes, they all went away, even the BCM codes. It's got a couple of TPMS codes. We'll have to revisit that. First, it's got to hold tranny fluid and not misfire, and we can go further. So we'll see what happens with it. Clearing the codes definitely work for now. And maybe some JB Weld on the coil would be good. I don't know. JB Weld on a tranny one. Have I told you I hate JB Weld? This stuff doesn't do anything. It's epoxy. It's metallized epoxy. So people love it though. They swear they fix their engine with it and stuff. And I'm sure there are instances where it will work. But if you have any oil or film and you haven't cleaned the metal surface 100%, the chances are next to nothing. And I haven't seen it work yet. Not long term. Temporarily, yeah, I've seen it work. But, you know, like you can put off replacing a radiator for a few weeks kind of thing. Anyway, to me, that's not a repair. That's just how I do things. Some people put JB Weld on something, sell their car on Facebook Marketplace, and they think it fixed it. And then the guy buys it 2 days later, radiator fails or whatever part it was. All right, we'll come back and see what else we're doing on this thing, and maybe there's something else to do. Parts are on the way. I don't know if we'll get them all today. I think the line probably tomorrow from because it's coming from the dealer. But we could pull the spark keys and the coil out of there.
There's one up.
Then we can put it back on there.
Yeah. And get rid of the other one?
Yeah.
That's terrible news. The boots is ripping. I'm not supposed to do that. That's unfortunate. One piece at a time, but we got it. JB Weld. JB Weld. JB Weld. Yeah, JB Weld. Trying to stop the aurora effect, which is high voltage causes magnetism around the between the ceramic and the metal. I mentioned it earlier, but I just think it's funny. They put it on all four spark plugs. So we silicone this broken piece back on because you have to change the whole coil. You can't get just the boot. So we're gonna make it work. Well, guys, we are running out of time. The parts aren't here yet. We're gonna be closing in about 5 minutes. Yeah, there's pretty bad traffic and it's raining on and off, so that's probably why the parts aren't here. So we're not going to get to finish this car in this video today. I apologize, but finish it in the morning. No big deal. So thanks for watching today's video. I appreciate your company. You guys don't realize how much I appreciate the support. We're closing on 17,000 subscribers now, so we're going to keep after it. Keep fixing cars, trying to keep people on the road, and learning and teaching and all that stuff. We want to build a big YouTube community here and help mechanics realize they're not alone and educate the public a little bit more on what's involved to do this. That's the whole reason for my channel. So thanks for that support. Torque the like button before you leave. And don't forget, you can check out a video in the corner here. There'll be a compilation and a video you can watch if you want to check out some more content before you go. Hope I see you in the next one, because you're awesome.